Our text this morning is taken from reading 1 Peter chapter 3 and at the beginning of verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. I think in the NIV it is Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. Moses, it is said, died at the age of 120. The Bible tells us that right to the end of his life, he was a strong man. Religious teachers tell us that Buddha died in calm serenity at the age of 80, surrounded by a host of followers who had been won over to his philosophy. Confucius died at 72 in his hometown of Lu in China, leaving a group of noble disciples to carry on his work. Muhammad, according to Muslim tradition, died at Mecca in the arms of his favorite wife. He was 62, a man of wealth and power, the political ruler of a united Arabia. Sometimes you hear it said that all religions are basically the same. All religions lead to God. Be good, be religious, and you'll get to heaven. And sometimes it's claimed that all great religions of the world are basically the same in their origin. Each were created by great men of intellect and understanding and spiritual insight, who upon discovering some great religious truth or principle, spent their whole lives teaching that to others. And certainly, as far as elements of Judaism and Buddhism and Confucianism and Islam are concerned, there is a measure of truth in that assertion. All these religions were founded by men who died in relatively old age. They died having spent their lives passing on their beliefs to others. They died, for the most part, amidst popular acclaim, the future of their movements guaranteed. In the whole gamut of world religions, there is only one that stands out as being radically different, and that is Christianity. Jesus died at the age of 33, after a teaching ministry of only 2 or 3 years. He was rejected by his own countrymen. He was betrayed and denied and deserted by his closest disciples and followers. The Bible tells us he was abandoned and forsaken even by God himself. The founder of Christianity did not die in old age. He did not die after some long, extensive teaching ministry. He did not die amidst popular acclaim. His death was premature and tragic and lonely on a cross, despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And surely the big question that raises is this: how did this man, who ended his life in such utter shame and disgrace, become the founder of the most important and influential religion the world has ever known? And the answer in part to that question lies in the nature and the significance of his death. Because that is where the biographical accounts of his life and ministry, the Gospels, focus our attention. By any normal standard, the Gospels are strange biographies. If someone's going to write someone's life history, they do not normally, as for example John does, spend the first 11 chapters on 99% of Jesus' life and 10 chapters on the last week. And it's the same with all the Gospels. Their focus is on Jesus' death. Some commentators describe Mark's gospel as an extended passion narrative. Why is that? It is because the apostles and the gospel writers realized that this was the key thing. This was the most important thing about Jesus. They realized that the cross is everything. And yeah, that of course just begs the question, doesn't it? Why? Why do the gospels focus their attention on the public execution of Jesus Christ? What was the significance of Christ's death? What was so special about it? Why has it been the burden of the Christian message and Christian preaching for 2,000 years? Why do Christians call the day of his death Good Friday? What is so good about it? And why do we today celebrate that death around a table spread with bread and wine? Our text today tells us exactly why. Christ died. Christ suffered for sins once for all. The righteous for the unrighteous, to bring us, or to bring you, to God. And what Peter's words reveal is that Jesus' death had a unique purpose. In his death, Jesus was accomplishing something that no other death could. And when the apostolic writers of the New Testament speak or of the cross or the death of Jesus, they're not simply referring to a physical wooden cross or the mere fact of his death. They are referring to the import of his death, to the significance of what was achieved there. That's what Christian theologians talk about, the work of Christ on the cross, referring to that which Jesus accomplished by his suffering and death. And our text this morning highlights for us some important aspects of Christ's work upon the cross. Let me mention some of these. And the first is this. I want you to notice with me that it was a costly work. A costly work. Christ suffered, it says. Christ suffered. Also, I think the NIV simply, some manuscripts, I think that's in a footnote in the ESV, Christ died. The original people to whom Peter was writing were Christians who were undergoing great suffering and trial. And Peter wanted to remind them of what happened to the Lord Jesus. He wanted to underline for them the fact of Jesus' suffering, that they might be encouraged and strengthened by his example. Here is the greatest example of someone suffering for doing good. And yet, it's a kind of ironic that in this passage of 1 Peter 3, in which Peter is highlighting the example of Jesus, that he speaks so clearly of the purpose of the cross. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. The events leading up to and including Jesus' death are sometimes referred to, aren't they, as his passion. It's a word that just means his suffering. The death of Jesus on the cross was not something easy and painless. It wasn't something imaginary or unreal. It was, of course, an excruciating death, literally. And this point is made not only in the Gospels but in many parts of the New Testament. Hebrews 13:12, Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Jesus himself said as he traveled towards Jerusalem, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation." And the events of Gethsemane, the garden, and the events of Calvary give us a glimpse. They give us a perspective on that suffering. In the garden, we're told that Jesus visibly shrank from the death he had to face. The prospect of that death was something that troubled him, that distressed him. Three times he prays, "My Father, if it be possible, may this cup be taken from me." That cup was a reference, of course, not to the physical pain of flogging and crucifixion, but to the pain of being abandoned and forsaken by his Father, consumed by the wrath of God against sin. It's actually interesting how the New Testament makes, the Gospels make, very little of the obvious physical sufferings that accompanied crucifixion. Gethsemane, Jesus shrank from the cup that was placed before him. Cup was a regular Old Testament symbol of God's wrath and judgment. Psalmist says, "In the hand of the Lord is a cup of foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours it out, and all the wicked of the earth drink it down to its very dregs." And so the ultimate agony and suffering of the cross for Jesus was drinking down that cup full of the moral pollution of the human race, dying as a man utterly cursed and forsaken and abandoned by God. As I was listening to Thomas last night, and that passage in Mark 15, and the passage, you remember, where Jesus is offered. He's suffering on the cross. He's dying on the cross. And the gospel writers tell us how he was offered a drink, wine and myrrh and so forth, and how he refused that and refused to take it. That kind of drink was a kind of, I suppose, a primitive narcotic. It was designed to dull the senses, to make things more bearable. But that was a cup that Jesus refused to drink. Why was that? Because he had to be in full possession of all his faculties. He had a ministry to perform on the cross. He had to suffer and die. There was to be no immunity or escape for Jesus. He had to taste all of death's bitterness and fear. I remember a long time ago now hearing a sermon by Professor MacLeod, and he was preaching at the Good Friday service at St. George's Tron in Glasgow. It must be 25 years ago or something. And his title was "The Unanesthetized Savior." And he told a story, I think, in that sermon of being with someone in a hospice who was dying. And the man refused the drugs that they offered him. And he said this: "I want to be alive when I die." And that was Jesus on the cross, refusing the narcotic that was offered him, because he had to be alive when he died. Jesus' death was costly. He suffered. He missed nothing, but he plumbed the depths of human anguish and pain on the cross. And friends, that means there is one who understands. There is one who knows. When we too travel that path of suffering and pain, there's one who knows the despondency and the questions and the loneliness and the pain that sometimes come our way. For Christ also suffered. The old hymns puts it like this, doesn't it? "We may not know, we cannot tell, what pains he had to bear, but we believe it was for us he hung and suffered there." A costly work. But secondly, here a sacrificial work. You'll notice also, Christ also suffered once for sins. For sins. Sin is the great problem, isn't it? It's the great problem for men and women. It's what creates that barrier between ourselves and our Creator God. It represents all that is wrong with us and all that is wrong with our world. All that is broken, all that is misshapen, all that is distorted. Represents all our rebellion against our Creator. All that makes us enemies of God. All that places us under the judgment and the wrath of God. My goodness, how can we come before God so unclean, so filthy, so dirty, so stained? A little phrase for sins here is likely derived from the language of the Greek Old Testament. There it was used to refer to the sacrifice that was offered in the Old Testament on the Day of Atonement. That sacrifice was offered for sins. And many of you will know the ritual involved. The high priest, the male goats, the sin offering. One of the goats sacrificed, its blood sprinkled in the inner part of the tabernacle or temple in the Holy of Holies. It was the place where the Ark of the Covenant had been kept, containing the tablets of the commandments. And over the top of the Ark was a golden slab known as the mercy seat, the place of propitiation. A word that means to turn aside someone's wrath or anger through the payment of a price. And only on that one day of the year, could anyone, the high priest, enter the Holy of Holies and sprinkle the blood of sacrifice on the mercy seat. And then he would come out and lay his hands on the head of the living goat and confess the sins of the people. And the second goat was driven outside the camp. The means of atonement signified by the sacrifice and the shedding and sprinkling of blood on behalf of the guilty. Only by this was access to God's presence granted. Only if God's anger and wrath be turned aside. Then the effect of that atonement, symbolized by the scapegoat, the carrying away of the sin of the people. And yet, of course, all these rituals, the ritual sacrifice of animals in the Old Testament and even the Day of Atonement itself could never really atone for human sin and human rebellion and human depravity. I mean, how could it do? The writer to the Hebrews says it is impossible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. These sacrifices were a foreshadowing, a pointing forward to the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. There's a hymn by Isaac Watts that captures the thought, not all the blood of beasts on Jewish altars slain could give the guilty conscience peace or wash away our stain. But Christ, the heavenly Lamb, takes all our sins away, a sacrifice of nobler name and richer blood than they. And the point is this, that access into the presence of a holy God is not cheap. God does not say to people, oh, just come any old way. There is only one way that men and women can come before a holy God. And Paul tells us in Romans 3:25 that it is Jesus. He is the sacrifice. He is our propitiation. He is our mercy seat. The death of Jesus on the cross was a sacrificial death, a fulfillment of all that the Old Testament system pointed forward to. It was for sins. The blood shed to take away sin and cancel its effects. Let's be clear that the sin that Jesus bore upon the cross is not sin as some sort of vague intellectual abstraction. He bore our sins upon his body upon the tree. Your sins and my sins. Real sins committed by real people. The sins that we have committed. Our lies, our lust, our anger, our selfishness, our pride, our apathy, our hatred, our cruelty. It was under the weight of all our sin. Jesus Christ was pitched into the very dark hole of suffering and despair and dereliction. John writes in his first letter, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the propitiation for our sins. For Christ suffered for sins, a costly work, a sacrificial work. And also here, I think, a finished work. Christ also suffered once for sin. Some translations have it once for all. The sacrifices of the Old Testament repeated again and again and again, every year, year in and year out. Jesus' sacrifice was once for all. The Jewish sacrificial system, a perpetual round of activity. Sacrifices going on and on and on. The ceremony, the rituals never ceased. The atonement they symbolized, never complete, never finished. High priest was always on his feet. There was always another sacrifice to be made. And that contrast with Christ's sacrifice on the cross is total. Because his sacrifice is unrepeatable. It is perfect and complete in every way. Now remember how in the writer to the Hebrews stresses, emphasizes this point again and again and again. Hebrews 7:27, unlike other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. Hebrews 9:28, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. Hebrews 10:10, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Hebrews 10:12, when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Christ's blood is in every way superior to that of bulls and goats. It is the blood of the eternal covenant. It is the precious blood of Christ, the Lamb of God, slain, in a sense, before the foundation of the world. And it's his blood that brings us access into the presence of God and into heaven itself. And that's why when Jesus died, you'll remember that the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. His blood brings us access. His blood brings us forgiveness. Remember John the Baptist when he saw Jesus by the river Jordan. What did he exclaim? Behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sin of the world. And unlike the animal sacrifices of the old covenant, Jesus' sacrifice was completely acceptable to God. A perfect, finished work. Cannot be repeated. It cannot be added to. Can it be augmented? Can it be supplemented in any way? It can only be trusted. Jesus' last words on the cross were, it is finished. Tetelestai, a word often stamped over bills in the ancient world to say, paid in full. It is finished. Not I am finished. It is finished. My work is accomplished. It is completed. It is done. A finished work cannot be improved upon, cannot be added to, cannot be repeated. It's absolutely perfect. It can only be trusted. Well, time marches on. A costly work, sacrificial work, a finished work. Fourthly, you'll notice a substitutionary work. Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous. Sometimes the just for the unjust. The death of Jesus on the cross was in our place. Jesus, the righteous one, suffers and dies for the unrighteous. And that concept of a substitute is highly significant and so important. It lies actually both at the heart of sin and the nature at the heart of salvation. John Stott, in his book, The Cross of Christ, writes this: "The essence of sin is in man substituting himself for God. The essence of salvation is in God substituting himself for man. Sin involves man rising up against God and placing himself where only God should be. Salvation involves God sacrificing himself where only man deserved to be. Sin entails man claiming an authority which belongs to God alone. Salvation entails God accepting the judgment which belongs to man alone." And friends, this is the very foundation of the Christian life. Remember Paul's words? He talks in Galatians 2:20 about the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That substitution brings with it the guarantee, because he took my place, that my sin can never be revisited. It is completely atoned for. I wonder if you grasp that, if you really understand that. It is completely atoned for. Well, sometimes we don't understand that, do we? I remember the story being told. It was of a Roman Catholic priest in some part of Asia who had great problems, trouble. He was a good priest. He worked hard in his parish, but he had a problem. And his problem was this: he had committed a sin in his younger days when he was in seminary, and it always troubled him. And he had no assurance, none at all. And it troubled him, and it troubled him, and it troubled him. And he had a lady in his congregation, and she was unusual. She used to claim to have visions, and she used to claim to be able to speak to Jesus. And he kind of gave this lady a wide berth usually, kept her at arm's length, and you can understand why. But one day he was so troubled, and he met this woman on the road, and he was speaking to her, and he said to her, he said, "The next time you have one of your visions and you're speaking to Jesus, ask him, what was the sin I committed when I was back in seminary?" And the lady said, "Oh yeah, I'll be delighted to do that, no problem at all, I'll have a word with Jesus, that's fine." And off she went. And a few weeks passed. And he was thinking about this. And he met the woman again, and she was hello, and had a chat. And he said, "You know, did you ever ask Jesus about that sin that I committed in seminary?" And the lady said, "Oh yes, yeah, I did speak to him about that." And I said, "Well, what did she say? What did he say?" "Oh," he said, "I don't remember. I don't remember." Jeremiah 31:34. "I will forgive their iniquities. I will remember their sin no more. I don't remember." That is because the work of Christ on the cross is a substitutionary work. Punishment of my sin has been fully met in the punishment of the substitute. It lies right at the heart of the gospel message. And we're here today and we're going to break bread and we're going to drink the wine and we're going to remember the God who remembers our sins no more. I think that gripped the Apostle Paul, the truth and the reality of that. I think it shaped his whole life and his whole ministry. The Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I wonder, can you say that this morning? I remember the story being told of the evangelist, Gypsy Smith, who towards the end of his life, he had a ministry that lasted almost 70 years, preaching the gospel. He was a sort of well-known preacher, evangelist in Britain and also in the United States. And he was traveling across the Atlantic, I think, to one of his last speaking engagements. And he was asked by someone about the secret of his long and fruitful ministry. How do you do it, Mr. Smith? How do you stay so fresh in the things of the Lord? His answer was this: dear friend, because I've never lost the wonder of it all. I've never lost the wonder. A costly work, a sacrificial work, a finished work, a substitutionary work. And finally here, a saving work. You notice that? The righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. Christ suffered. Christ died to bring you to God. He died to do for us what we could not ever do for ourselves. He died to bring you to God. This is what the gospel is about, isn't it? Jesus Christ brings men and women like us to God. That's the good news. Who is Peter referring to here in these words? Who are those Christ has died for that they might be brought into God's presence? Well, I think the opening verses of the letter tell us to whom it was written in 1 Peter 1 and 2. To God's elect, strangers in the world who've been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling by his blood. In other words, the you of this verse to bring you to God, to bring us to God, the us of this verse is not general. It's actually very specific. It refers to those who have been chosen and sanctified and sprinkled. It refers to those who have been given new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. It's a reference to those who've come to faith in Jesus. So let me ask you, has Jesus Christ died to bring you to God? Have you turned in faith and repentance to the Lord Jesus? Doesn't matter the kind of person you are or even the kind of person you think you are. Jesus Christ died to bring sinners to God. Our sins may be respectable once. Pride and gossip and jealousy and deceit and hypocrisy. Or our sins may be more obvious. Violence or marital unfaithfulness or theft or whatever. But whatever your sins may be, let me tell you this, they can be blotted out. They can be wiped away. They can be forgiven. They can be forgotten. Because you're a good person? No. Because you come along to church? No. Because you're fairly religious? No. Because you say your prayers at night? No. Because you read the Bible? No. Because you haven't done anybody any harm? No. Because you're trying your best? No. Because Christ died to bring you to God. Christ died to bring you to God. It's the only way. and our good works and our best efforts and our fine words, these things, whatever they may be, they will never bring any human being to God. They will never bring us forgiveness. There's only one way, and that's through the cross. A costly work, a sacrificial work, a finished work, a substitutionary work, a saving work. Salvation is found in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. No other way. No other way of forgiveness. The Living Bible paraphrases these verses, or this verse of 1 Peter. Christ also suffered. He died once for the sins of all of us guilty sinners, although he himself was innocent of any sin at any time, that he might bring us safely home to God. Safely home to God. No one else has suffered and died to bring you home to God. Certainly not Moses, or Buddha, or Confucius, or Muhammad. There have been lots of noble deaths over the years, moving sacrifices. But Jesus' death is categorically different. It was that God might say to us, your sins are forgiven, that we might be brought to God. It's a story, I think it's from Africa somewhere, of a fire that took place in a remote village, in one of these little huts made of straw. And the fire took hold, and because of the materials the little hut was made from, it was so flammable, it went up so quickly. And the family within the little hut were killed, all except one little baby, a little baby boy, who it appeared had been snatched out of the flames, or just before, as the fire had taken hold. And the baby boy had been left at the center of the village. And everyone had gathered, and they were marveling that this little boy had been saved and rescued, and they were saying this was a miracle, and they were saying this, the gods had shined, this was a great blessing. And then there was a discussion that took place to see who would adopt the little boy. And some were saying, well, we will adopt him because, you know, we've got a large family. And others were saying, well, I'm a prince and I've got many cattle and we should adopt this boy. And there was many competing voices. And then a man came through the crowd of villagers. And he said, I will adopt the boy. And everybody looked at him. He was a nobody. He was a nothing. He did not have many cattle. He wasn't somebody rich or wealthy or significant or important or had status in the community. And they looked at him and they said, you? Well, why should you adopt this child? And then the man raised his hands, burnt and charred and disfigured hands, disfigured by the flame. He had the greatest claim. The man with the scars on his hands. Friends, we may have respect for other religious leaders and teachers and so forth, but only Jesus has the scars on his hands. Only he can say to us, this is my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Others may claim to teach, instruct, encourage. Only Jesus claims to save. No one else can bring us to God. Those scars and wounds of Jesus Christ speak to us of God's forgiveness. No one can bring us that. Without him, we're lost. We will face God's anger and wrath on our own. We will remain unforgiven. Our sins will not be forgotten. There's only one way to be made right with God. One way to be forgiven. We give up on ourselves. Discover we need Jesus. His righteousness, his forgiveness, his cross. The only way to heaven is on our knees, trusting in Jesus Christ, for he is the only person who wears still those scars of rescuing love. Come to him this morning, and then you will be able to say, Christ died to bring me to God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that it was a costly work, a sacrificial work, a finished work, a substitutionary work, and ultimately a saving work. Lord, may you apply that work to our lives, to our hearts, to our minds. And so as we come later on to the table, we may receive Jesus Christ by faith. And we may lean our whole confidence upon him, not upon ourselves, not upon anything in us, but completely and utterly upon him. Help us to remember you, the one who remembers our sins no more. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We sing together Psalm 130 from Sing Psalms. Lord, from the depths I call to you. Lord, hear me from on high. Give attention to my voice when I for mercy cry. Lord, in your presence, who can stand if you our sins record? But yet forgiveness is with you, that we may fear you, Lord. Psalm 130 from Sing Psalms, page 173.
Lord, from the depths I call to you. Lord, hear me from on high and give attention to my voice when I for mercy cry. Lord, in your presence who can stand if you our sins record? But yet forgiveness is with you that we may fear you, Lord. I wait, my soul waits for the Lord. My hope is in his word. More than the watchman waits for dawn, my soul waits for the Lord. Oh, Israel, put your hope in God, for mercy is with him, and full redemption from their sins his people will redeem.
At this point in our service, we come to the Lord's table. It's good to be reminded that it is his table, not ours, not our churches, not belong to any minister or elders, any denomination. It is the Lord's table. It's His. He is the one who invites His people to come and to eat and to drink. We come at His invitation. We come responding to His grace and His goodness. It's a table that's been prepared by Jesus. Prepared at a great cost. A tremendous cost. Prepared by one who still wears the scars on his hands. And he prepares this table for us, his people. For those who believe in his name. For those who have trusted in him for salvation. I think John Newton, it was the hymn writer of Amazing Grace, who said towards the end of his life, as he was quite old and frail, he said, "I have forgotten many things, but there's two things I have not forgotten. I am a great sinner, and Jesus Christ is a great Savior." And friends, that's what this table tells us. It reminds us that we're great sinners. But better than that, more than that, it reminds us that Christ is a great and wonderful Savior. If you belong to Him, then come to the table and eat and fellowship with Him and enjoy His presence. We sing together in Psalm 118 from verse 15 and following, page 398, Psalm 118 in the Scottish Psalter from 15 and following, and we'll sing until we are ready to come to the table.
Indwellings of the righteous, is heard the melody of joy and health, the Lord's right hand, the ever valiant to them.
stone is made head cornerstone, which builders did despise. This is the doing of the Lord, and wondrous in our eyes.
I read to you from these verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul writes, he says this: "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and blood of the Lord. The person examine himself then. So eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment." Let us pray. For our Father, we thank you and praise you and worship you, acknowledging all that you have done for us through the Lord Jesus Christ. We acknowledge that we are great sinners. Thank you that by your grace we have discovered and found a great Savior. Lord, we thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ. We remember his birth in lowly circumstances. We remember his life of perfect obedience to your will. We remember how he perfectly fulfilled your law, internally and externally. We thank you that he lived a life of perfect righteousness, a life for all his people. We thank you this morning, not only for his life, and indeed for his teaching and instruction. We thank you most of all, most wonderful, for his death on Calvary's cross, for bearing shame and scoffing wood in my place, condemned. Lord, we thank you that Jesus Christ died for us, that he died for our sins, that he died for our salvation, that he died for our forgiveness, that he died that we might be yours and yours for all eternity. Lord, we thank you that that death was not the end for Jesus Christ. We thank you that you raised him from the dead on the third day. We thank you that he was proclaimed king. We thank you that he is now exalted to your right hand. Thank you that he reigns and rules over all things. We thank you this morning that he's here with us in the power of the Holy Spirit. stooped down to be with us. Lord, minister by your Spirit in our midst this morning. Make Christ real to us. Renew us inwardly by your Spirit. We may truly feed on Christ by faith. Lord, you know us. You know all of us in this building this morning. You know our hearts and you know our minds. Lord, do us good. Minister to us by your grace. Whoever we are, whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. Lord, if we are your people, then richly bless us and strengthen us for your service, we pray. As we give thanks for bread and wine, and as we set these elements apart for this special feast, as we take them, may we take Christ by faith, and may he reign and rule in our hearts and in our lives. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come to the table, it's good to be reminded of one of the great qualifications coming to this table. Coming to any table and to any meeting. And that is appetite. And be hungry. Not hungry for the things of this world, but are we hungry for Jesus Christ? Do we have an appetite for Christ? Do we want to once again taste and see that the Lord is good? What a great privilege it is to come and to take bread and wine. Come hungry and feed on Christ. May he reign and may he rule in your heart, in your life, in your mind, and in your soul. The night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and told that he broke it, and after having given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body. It's broken for you. So take it, eat it." Again, on that same night in which he was betrayed, he took the cup. He said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. My blood that's shed for the forgiveness of sins. So take it and drink it and remember me." Thank you. morning. There's a green hill far away. Last verse of that hymn says, "Oh, dearly, dearly he has loved. We must love him too. Trust in his redeeming blood. Try his works to do." We've been meeting around the Lord's table. We've been reminded of how dearly he loves us, how costly that love is, how sacrificial, how wonderful that love is. What is the response that we need to make to his love? And the hymn writer really sums it up very, very well. Dearly, dearly, he has loved. We must love him too. We must love him. And so as we go from this place later on, we must go with that love for Jesus Christ. We must take that love with us into our daily lives. We must love him. We love him because he first loved us. We must love him and we must trust him. Trust in his redeeming love. We must keep on trusting him. Keep on believing those great promises that he's made to us. Try his works to do. We must go resolving. We never do it perfectly. But we go resolving to do his will and to do his works. Our homes, amongst our families, amongst our neighbours, our colleagues, in our community. Let's love him. Let's trust him. Let's try his works to do. Sing together Psalm 103, verses 1 through 4. "Thou my soul, bless God, the Lord." Page 369 in the Psalter. Sorry, sir.
Oh, thou my soul.
Let's pray together. Let's pray. God, our Father, we thank you for all that we have and all that we enjoy in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that every part, every aspect, every dimension of our salvation is to be found in him and in him alone. We thank you that there is no other name given amongst men by which we must be saved. We thank you that we find redemption in him. We find freedom in Jesus Christ. Freedom to be who we were meant to be, your children. We thank you for the redemption that is ours in Christ. We thank you that it was his condemnation upon the cross, that it was through his sacrifice, that it was through him taking our place, that we have come to know forgiveness and new life. We thank you that there is cleansing, a powerful cleansing, in the blood of Jesus Christ. We thank you that there is in him a pardon, full and free. We thank you in that fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, that sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. We thank you that there is righteousness in Jesus Christ, an absolutely perfect righteousness, a complete righteousness, a righteousness that covers over our entire lives. We thank you that there is new life in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. We thank you that there is protection and safety in the abundant blessings of his kingly reign. And how we thank you that though crucified, he is now risen and ascended to your right hand. How we thank you for that promise that one day he shall come again. Lord, we thank you for all our heavenly inheritance that's found in Jesus, for all those blessings, the fulfillment of all your promises down through the centuries that are to be found and discovered and enjoyed in Jesus Christ alone. Lord, bless us and encourage us and strengthen us for the future. We do not know what lies ahead, but we know that our lives are in your hands. Lord, lead us and guide us. Help us to love you. Help us to love Christ. Help us to trust in his redeeming blood. And help us to try his works, indeed his will to do, in every aspect of our living. Receive our thanks and receive our worship. We offer and bring everything to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Sacrament of the Lord's Supper is a means of grace, and it's a means of grace to all of us who gather here today. It's a means of grace to those who communicate and have taken bread and wine, but it's also a means of grace to those who didn't, because it is a proclamation of the love of God in Jesus Christ. And it's a proclamation not just to us, it's a proclamation to the whole world. that there is a God and that he loves his people with an everlasting love. And nothing, absolutely nothing, could separate us from that love in Christ Jesus our Lord. We sing to God's praise and glory in Psalm 72, the Scottish Psalter, verses 17 through 19. His name forever shall endure. That's page 314. Psalm 72, from verse 17 through 19, on page 314.
His name forever shall endure, vast like the sun it shall. Men shall be blessed in him and blessed all nations shall.
Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace this day and forevermore. Amen.